Okay. Bruchim Aboyim, welcome to the study of Pirkei Avos. We are in the beginning, as we do every night. We're starting with Kol Yisrael Yesh Lahem Chelek, and you see that David Beck, thank you, was able to get for us the introduction that we say every night. Kol Yisrael Yesh Lahem Chelek Li'olam Abo. All of Kol Yisrael has a share in the world to come. Shenemar. Like the pasuk in Yeshayahu says, "V'ameich kulam tzadikim," your entire nation is righteous. "La'olam yirshu oretz," they shall forever inherit the land. "Netzer matoi," they are the branch of my planting. "Maaseh yadai lehispoer," they are the work of my hand that I may be glorified. And while I'm on this, I'm going to mention that everyone knows that in Chodesh Nisan, there's a once a year bracha that you could say, which is the bracha on new fruit trees. Now, many people are under the impression that therefore, because it's only in Chodesh Nisan, you have only one day left to say that bracha before a fruit tree that's beginning to blossom. But la halacha, that's not so. The halacha is that it's okay if you say it in Chodesh Nisan, but in our climates, most fruit trees will not yet begin to blossom. Many won't. And in fact, the bracha can be said all the way through June. And even parts of July, as long as the fruit is not fully ripe, you can say the Birchas HaIlonos. It's a once a year bracha. You only say it once and only when you see a fruit tree that is in bloom that's not completely done. So even if you haven't said it yet and you won't get a chance to say it tomorrow, which is the last day of Nisan, you can say it in Iyar, you can say it in Sivan, probably even parts of Tammuz, because the fruit trees around here don't get ripe by that time. So please keep that in mind. The bracha, of course, can be found in Yesidah. And it has to do with the concept that HaKadosh Baruch Hu is Shelochisar Dovar Biolomo. Nothing is missing in his world. Uvora vo brios tovos v'ilonos tovim. And by the way, some Sidurim have the wrong word. Instead of ilonos tovim, they say ilonos tovos, when it's really ilonos tovim. Lehanos bahem b'nei adam. In order that people have pleasure. That's the bracha. It's once a year. You can say it quite a while yet to go. And we now go to the Mishnah in Pirkei Avos that we started with. Here we go. We're up to Mishnah over here. It says Mishnah, hey, and Hillel is talking. Hillel is still talking. He has a lot of important messages to say. And here we come across the beginning of this Mishnah where it says, Hu Haya Omer. Now translated simply, Hu Haya Omer means he used to say. Our Chazal point out that when it says, Hu Haya Omer, he used to say, it doesn't just mean that he said it once in a while or he said it periodically. These were aphorisms that Hillel said on a daily, perhaps, certainly weekly or monthly basis. Regularly, when you spoke to Hillel, you would hear things that were extremely similar, or these exact words you would hear from Hillel. And here's what he used to say. Ein boor yirei chet. A person who's a boor, and we're going to translate boor in a few moments, but an empty person, a boor, like a boar, a pit. There's nothing there but emptiness. Ein boor yirei chet. A person who's a boor, he's a boorish person. That's the English word. He's a boorish person. Ein boor yirechev. A boor will not fear sin. Velo am ha'aretz chosid. And an ignoramus cannot become a righteous person in the terminology of the word chosid. He can't become an extremely pious person. Velo habayshon lameid. And the one who is a baishan, he's very mevayesh himself. He's very embarrassed. He's embarrassed to do anything. He has no confidence. So velo habayshan lameid, a person who is very timid, he is not going to be able to learn. And we're going to explain why. Velo hakapton melameid, and a person who is a kapton, he's makpid on everything. He's very exacting or very strict. someone who is very strict or exacting, and he's makpid on everything, lo hakapton melamed. A person who's a kapton cannot teach. And velo kol hamarbe b'schora machkim. And not everyone who is deeply involved in business becomes wise. Some do, but not everyone who's deeply involved in buying and selling becomes wise. Uvemokom she'ein anoshim, and in a place where there aren't people, and when it says anoshim, it means where there are no upstanding righteous people, histadel lehiyosish, you have to still stand up and be a righteous person. Hashem ish melchama, Hashem shemo, we have to be an ish tzaddik. We have to emulate God and stand up for that which is correct. Let's analyze this particular Mishnah. Now, it starts out by saying, he used to say, ein bor yirei chet. The Abarbanel explains what a bor is. A bor is someone who's eino b'mikra. He doesn't read psukim and learn chumash. Below b'mishnah, he doesn't learn the mishnayic concepts and statements. Velo b'derech eretz. In addition to not learning written scripture and oral scripture, he doesn't also get involved in derech eretz. Now, derech eretz here does not mean that he doesn't have respect, as we usually term derech eretz. But velo derech eretz means he doesn't produce anything. He doesn't work. He doesn't want to be bothered with the pursuits of the world. He doesn't want to learn. He doesn't want to learn Chumash. He doesn't learn Chumash. He doesn't learn Mishnah. Or she doesn't learn Chumash and Mishnah and doesn't do anything. No job, no activity, just personal pleasure pursuits. Such a person, says the Mishnah, ein bor yirei chet. Such an empty person, such a boorish individual, will not fear sin. Then it says, "V'lo amo aretz chasid," and an ignoramus can't be a righteous chasid. Notice the change in the language, if you will. Look what it says first: "Ein bor yirei chet." Ein. What does ein mean? It won't be. A bor will not be a yirei chet. But velo means not. Velo am ha'aretz chasid. But an am ha'aretz will not be a chasid. What's the difference between ein and lo? There's a tremendous difference, the Mili the other says. Because ein means it's impossible. Someone who doesn't learn anything and someone who doesn't get involved in the tikkun ha'olam, that person will never fear sin. But it's possible that an am ha'aretz could be a chassid. It's possible for a person who's ignorant can be extremely pious and extremely righteous, following his own feelings of closeness to God and dictating his behavior in a righteous, pious way. So that's the difference between ein and lo. Now let's analyze a little bit what it means when it says, ein bor yirei chet. Notice please, it doesn't say ein bor yirei Elokim. It doesn't say that an empty person can't be God-fearing. It could be that a bor is God-fearing. It could be the person who has no learning at all and doesn't do anything to make the world a better place. But the person could still be a Yirei Shamayim. He could be a God-fearing person. But he won't be a Yirei Chet. He won't be someone who fears sin. Now we have to explain what the difference between them is. The Teferes Yisrael, that great commentary on the Mishnah, gives us an insight. And it's really based, I believe, on the Ramban. The Ramban asks a very interesting question. What's the difference between Yiras Shamayim and Ahavas Hashem. What's the difference between Yiras Hashem and Ahavas Hashem? What's the difference between Ahava and Yira? What does Yiras Hashamaya mean? If a person is, when it says Mo Hashem Shoel Me'imach Kiyam Liyira Oso, the Pasuk in Devarim says Mo Hashem Shoel Me'imach. What does Hashem ask of you? Kiyam Liyira Oso, only to fear Him. From which the Gemara learns out Al Kol Bidei Shamayim Chutz Me'iras Shamayim. Everything is in the hands of the heavens except for the fear of heaven. Fear of heaven is the one commodity that is totally up to the free will of an individual. Even though a lot of what happens, almost everything that happens in our lives is predicated and based on what Hashem wants, but the fact of the matter is that there is one area that Hashem made a miracle. Just like He made a miracle in creating the world out of something from nothing, so He made a nace. He created a space where you can make free will decisions. And that free will decision is in one area, whether or not you're going to be Yiras Shamayim. Hakol bidei Shamayim, chutz mi Yiras Shamayim. So what's the difference between Yira and Ahava? So the difference between Yira and Ahava is the following. In a simple way, Yira means you won't do the wrong thing. Someone who has Yiras Shamayim is not going to do something against the Torah. He won't do something wrong. But Ahava is an expression, I'm going to do something right. Ahava Hashem means I want to do what Hashem wants me to do. He's the kind of person who wants to help others, a person who runs to do mitzvahs, a person who's eager to daven and daven with kavanah, so he has a connection or she has a connection with Hashem. So that's the difference between Ahava and Yira. But let me ask you another thing. Is there or are there different types of Yira? Are there different types of Yira? What does this mean? We're supposed to have Yira Shamayim. What are we afraid of? Is it we're afraid of being zapped? Oh, if I do this thing, I'm going to get potched. I'm going to suffer. Is that Yira Shamayim? Maybe. It may be Yiras Shamayim. But the Ramban feels that Yiras Shamayim is very close to Ahava Shamayim. And Yiras Shamayim means Yira Horomimus, the fear of the exalted position of HaKadosh Baruch Hu. His Yir is Romimus, like Ram Venisa, exalted, high and mighty. There's a Yira of this exalted position. And let me see if I can describe how we could apply that in our lives. Any of us who've ever felt a tremendous sense of love for someone, if we've felt a tremendous sense of love for someone, perhaps a spouse, a child, a parent, if there's a tremendous, or a friend, if there's, or a great person, if there's a tremendous sense of love for another, you have a fear of hurting them. There's a Yiras Haromimus. There's a fear of hurting the other person, of doing something that's going to cause them pain. You tremble over the idea that you might actually hurt that person or someone. It may not be an expression of doing something right for the person, because that's love, but there will be a sense of Yira. Oh, I tremble to think that I would hurt you. That would hurt somebody. It hurts so much when you hurt someone you love. It's like so painful. I remember when I was younger, and my son was a little boy crawling around the house. And at one point, he was crawling by a door, and I didn't want him to get his fingers caught in the door. So I ran over and closed the door without realizing that I was getting his fingers caught in the door. And he gave a scream, and I realized I did it. It was terrible. Oh, was that painful? Because you don't want to hurt someone you love. And that's a Yira. So the Ramban says that the Yiras Haromimus is one level of Yira. Then we have a Yiras Shamayim somewhere in the middle. a Yiras Shemayim that talks about Hakol Bidei Shemayim Chutz Miyiras Shemayim. Someone who's afraid to do something that's against the Torah, and that's what we're talking about over here when it says Yiras Chet. This boor cannot get to that point of being afraid to do chet, but he is capable of having the lowest level of Yiras Shamayim. And that is, I don't want God to zap me. I don't want him to punch me. I don't want him to hurt me. So we have three levels of Yiras Shamayim. We have the exalted level, the thinking, intelligent approach to Yiras Shamayim. I'm not afraid of being zapped. Of course Hashem could zap me. He gave me life. He controls everything. But that's not my connection with Hashem, you could say to yourself. My connection is, there's a love. And when you love, you don't want to hurt. And so the Yiras Haromimus is the highest level of Yiras Shamayim. Then you have the level that's mentioned over here by Hillel of Yirei Chet. A person who's a boor, he may have some Yiras Shamayim, but he's not going to have Yiras Chet. That he won't have. He may have Yiras Shamayim, which is the lowest level, meaning he may be afraid of getting hurt. God will punish me if I do the wrong thing. He's afraid of the onesh, of the zapping, of the punishment. So Hillel is telling us this very important statement. Ein bur yirei chet. Someone who is devoid of social concerns. He's devoid of the study of the basic principles. Not because he can't, but because he doesn't do it. For whatever reason, he cannot be the second level yirei chet. If he gets to the point where at some point he's a chacham, he will come to the point of the highest level of yira, which is yiras haromimus. And beyond the level of yiras haromimus, then you have ahavas Hashem. So Hillel is starting out by telling us, number one, ein bur yirei chet. He's not going to be a God-fearing person, but he is someone who is capable of having a basic understanding of not doing sin because of the possibility that he may be punished. We go to the next statement over here. Below Amo Aretz Chassid. A person who is ignorant can't be a Chassid. Now, how do you translate the word Chassid? The real word Chassid is that a person who does Midus Chassidus. The concept in halacha of Midus Chassidus means that the person goes lifnim mishuras adin. They go beyond the simple line of the law. Someone who is an Am Ha'aretz and doesn't know what Midus Chassidus is because he's ignorant. He doesn't understand what the Midas Chassidus is. Tomorrow in the daf, for instance, we're going to learn the question, is wearing tefillin all day, I'm giving one example here, is wearing tefillin all day a halacha, or is it a Midas Chassidus? If it's a halacha, then we have to wear it all day. If it's a Midas Chassidus, then people who are extremely pious end up wearing tefillin all day. Now, there are people who wear tefillin all day. There are righteous Hasidish people. Doesn't mean that they're Hasidish in dress, because, for instance, Reb Chaim Pinchas Scheinberg Zal was not a Hasidish person, but he wore tefillin all day. Is it a Midas Hasidus, or is it a requirement? An Am Ha'aretz who doesn't know the difference between what's basically required and what's a Midas Hasidus cannot ever become a chassid. It's impossible for that person to become a chassid. And then Hillel said, "V'lo habayshan lamed." And the one who is embarrassed to ask, he will never be able to ask. And why won't he ever learn? Why won't he ever learn if he's embarrassed to ask? Because he's never going to know what to do. The person is embarrassed to ask. Why should someone be embarrassed to ask? Let me say right out. I very often get calls, and someone gets on the line and says, Rabbi Snow, I say, yes. I say, listen, I hope you don't mind. I'm sure it's a very silly question. It really, I'm so embarrassed, I shouldn't even ask it. It's really silly. That's what they say to me. You should know that there is no such thing as a silly question. There is no such thing as asking the way we would say it in the colloquial language today, that's a stupid question. There's no such thing. It doesn't exist. If it's a sincere inquiry about halacha or advice or behavior, it's not silly at all. So what is it, if there's no such thing as a silly question, what is the holding the Baishan back from learning? Now here's a twist of psychological movement of something that hits a person and we don't even realize that it's not what we think it is. Some people might think, I'm being so humble when I don't call and ask this question. I don't want to bother the person. He's such a busy person, such a busy rabbi, such a busy teacher. He doesn't have time for me. I'm not going to call. So the person never learns. You don't know what's going on in the world. You don't know halacha. You can look it up if you know how to look, if you know where to look. The truth of the matter is, having smicha doesn't mean you know everything. Having smicha means you know where to look. You know where to turn. In the yeshiva, in Tveres Yishlayim, when Reb Moshe Zatzal gave us smicha, so the joke was Reb Moshe would give us two pieces of paper. On one paper would be the smicha, and on the other piece of paper would be his phone number, so that we can call him when we had shailos, which we did. We did. At the beginning, we did a lot. And consequently, why is it that a person won't ask a question? So the Mefarshim come along and say it is not because of humility. On the contrary, it's because of conceit. I don't want to appear in his eyes like I don't know what I'm talking about. I don't want to appear silly. I don't want to appear that I'm asking a foolish question. My ego can't handle that. Turns out that the person's not a Baishan at all. The exact opposite. The person is too haughty. And therefore, Hillel says, no good. Lo a Baishan lamed. You're never going to learn anything if you're going to say, I'm too embarrassed to ask because I don't want to be put in the position where I'm thought of as being a little bit less than what I really are. And of course, just like lo habayshan lamed, the lo hakapton melamed. A person who is a strict person cannot teach. Now, we don't have any more time to discuss that particular point. We're going to come back in Yitzhak Hashem on Sunday night. On Sunday night at 7:45, we're going to pick this Mishnah up where we left off right over here, where it says v'lo hakapton melamed. And Yitzhak Hashem, at that time, we're going to try to crunch those three words, and the person who is extremely impatient or very strict cannot teach, and we'll explain why that's so, and how this entire statement fits in with Hillel's worldview, with his Weltanschauung, because Hillel's worldview was predicated upon things that he himself was involved in, as in Yetzer Hashem, we hope to discuss on Sunday night. So at 7:45, everybody is welcome to come back and join us for this particular segment of the Torah learning that we do over here, which is recorded. And in Yetzer Hashem, we will continue at that time. Right now, we're going over to the Mishnayos and to Halacha. I thank everyone for coming. I wish those who are staying, kol hakavod, and those who are leaving, please have a wonderful, wonderful Shabbos. And check our website. There's a Dvar Torah on the Parsha, which is a little different than the usual. But, you know, we're in unusual times, so it's going to be that way. Have a wonderful Shabbos, and we're continuing right now with the Mishnayos.